Hello, this is Rubab, your audio navigator. Here I'll help you out with the topic S, P and D block elements. This topic gives the idea about how the different block elements behave, what are the common features which they exhibit and how they are different from each other. 1 to 2 marks questions are generally asked from this topic. So let's start with oxides. Now first of all you need to know what are oxides, how they can be divided into different groups like acidic oxides, basic oxides and amphoteric oxides, and apart from them there are neutral oxides, peroxides and dioxides, compound oxides. So you should know about the examples and general features of each group. Then how are they prepared? For example, by direct heating of an element with oxygen or by reaction of oxygen with compounds at higher temperatures, by oxidation of some metals with nitric acid, or some by oxidation of some non-metals with nitric acid. So go through the examples of all of these. Then what are the structure of oxides? For example, oxides of metals, then molecular oxides. Now after that, what are the general reactions which the oxides exhibit? For example, first of all, reduction, which could be done by carbon or by heating or by displacement or by hydrogen. Reduction can also be done by electrolysis. So you need to go through the examples of reactions for each of these. Then after that, what happens when hydrolysis is done of the oxides? And what are the few very commonly known oxides with their formula and what are the usage? Then what is the trend which they follow in their acid-base behavior? In a periodic table, through a period or through a group, along the period or along the group, how the oxides of elements in a period become progressively more acidic as one goes from left to right in a period of the periodic table. And what happens when we move along the group? So all these features you should learn about them. Now comes the halides. For that, you first of all you need to know what are halogens. They are located on the left of the noble gases on the periodic table. These are the 5 toxic non-metallic elements, make up group 17 of the periodic table and consist of fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine and astatine. Then how do they form halides? How do they form halides with the alkali metals? What is the general formula? Then what are their physical and chemical properties? Then how do they form halides with the alkaline earth metals? What is the general formula of that? What are the chemical and physical properties? Then after that, how the halides of boron family are formed? What is the general formula for them? These are mostly covalent compounds. Then what are the physical properties and chemical properties of these? For example, trifluoride boron is a colorless gas. Trichloride boron and tribromide boron are colorless fuming liquids. And triiodide boron is a white solid at room temperature. And they mostly behave as Lewis acids. Then likewise, how the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen families form halides. What is the general formula and what are the physical and chemical properties? Just go through them. Now comes hydrides of alkali, alkaline earth metals, boron, aluminium, silicon, nitrogen, phosphorus and sulfur. For that, first of all, you should know what are hydrides and what kinds of different hydrides are present. First of all, the covalent hydrides, example, hydrogen chloride and ammonia. Then comes the ionic hydrides. They generally form with the group 1 and group 2 metals. Then there are metallic hydrides, where the hydrogen bonds with the transition elements. Then what are transition metal hydride complexes? What are the general formula for them? Then what are deuterides? Then what are the general nomenclature which is used for hydrides? For example, boron hydride is known as borane. Aluminum hydride is known as alumane, etc. Then after that, what are the applications of the hydrides, different hydrides? The subtopics which I have discussed here, questions could come regarding the formula of the molecules. Then what are the physical and chemical properties? So cover the maximum examples which you can do. Then after that comes the general characteristics of 3D elements. Then what are these 3D block elements, which are also known as first transition metal series, which includes scandium, titanium, vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper and zinc. You should be knowing that why are they called 3D elements based on the electronic configurations. Then what are the general physical characteristics of the 3D block series? These transition metals are the most important structural metals for industry due to their strength arising from the strong interatomic forces. Strong bonding is due to the small ionic radii. Then what are the other physical properties? Just go through them. Their structures, melting and boiling points, densities, etc. Then after that, the chemical characteristics. The four classic chemical characteristics are like complex formation, formation of colored ions, variable oxidation state, catalytic activity by the elements and their compounds. So go through each of it in detail. Like what is coordination number? How the relative ease of oxidation state change explained? What are the different ionization energies? That was all about the 3D block elements. Both are important physical as well as the chemical properties. Now comes the coordination complexes and the theories related to it. Before going into detail, first you should know what is a coordination complex, what is waters of hydration, what are the basics of coordination complexes and the term used related to it, like central atom, ligands, coordinate, covalent bond, coordination sphere, how the ligands are defined, like monodentate, bidentate or polydentate, what are chelating agents, what is actually chelation. After that, the study about structure and bonding in transition metal complexes. First of all, what is Werner coordination theory? Then according to it, what is primary valency and secondary valency? What is the 18 electron rule, which is based on earlier EAN rule given by Sydbick? Then according to this, the stable low oxidation state complexes are found to have a total of 18 bonding electrons. And the stability of these 18 electron species can be explained using MO theory. Then what are the limitations of this theory? The next is the valence bond theory. Who proposed this theory? VBT is based on the Hitler-London model of covalent bonds. Then what are the assumptions and features of valence bond theory? For example, the coordination compounds. Contain metal ions in which ligands form covalent coordinate bonds to the metal. Ligands must have a lone pair of electrons. Metal should have an empty orbital of suitable energy available for bonding. Atomic orbitals are used for bonding rather than molecular orbitals. This theory is useful to predict the shape and stability of the metal complexes. And now, what are the limitations of this theory? Like, it's unable to explain why some complexes are colored and others are not. And also doesn't explain the temperature dependence of the magnetic properties. I'll go through the few important examples. Then after this, you need to go through the crystal field theory. Who proposed this theory? What are the assumptions of this theory? For example, the interactions between the metal ion and the ligands are purely electrostatic. The ligands are regarded as point charges. If the ligand is negatively charged, ion-ion interaction. If the ligand is neutral, ion-dipole interaction. The electrons on the metal are under repulsive from those on the ligands. The electrons on metal occupy those d orbitals farthest away from the direction of approach of ligands. Then what is symmetric field? What is octahedral field? Now the structures of octahedral complexes. Then what is delta naught? That is the extent to which two sets of orbitals are split. Is denoted as delta naught. Then what happens when more than one electron is present in the d orbital? What is pairing energy? What are the factors on which delta naught is dependent on, like nature of the ligands, the charge on the metal ion, whether the metal is a 3d, 4d or 5d element? What are the weak field ligands and strong field ligands based on the delta naught? Based on this, what is the spectrochemical series? What is the formula for the measurement of CFSE? Then what are the applications of crystal field theory? How it helps in defining lattice energy, hydration enthalpy, ionic radii, etc. Then the structures for the tetrahedral complexes. What are the considerations taken for tetrahedral field? How the delta naught is defined for them? Why the tetrahedral complexes are high spin? Because due to the CFSE is normally smaller than the pairing energy. What are spinels? Normal spinel and inverse spinel. Go through the examples of each. Then after that, the role of coordination complexes in biochemistry. For example, hemoglobin, myoglobin, chlorophyll. Go through their structures. Now coming to the other properties of coordination complexes. First of all, go through the geometrical structure which they exhibit, like linear or trigonal planar, tetrahedral, trigonal bipyramidal, octahedral, pentagonal, square, antiprismatic, tricap, trigonal prismatic, etc.
with examples of each. What is the John Taylor stabilization theory? After this, the isomerism. There are many kinds of isomerism found in coordination complexes like stereoisomerism, cis-trans isomerism, and facial meridional isomerism, and optical isomerism. What are these? Clear your concepts about these and go through the examples. Then after that, the structural isomerism. For example, ionization isomerism, solvate or hydrate isomerism, linkage isomerism, or coordination isomerism. You should know what are these with examples. The next property is the color of transition metal complexes. They have spectacular colors caused by the electronic transitions by the absorption of light. So go through the various examples of colors of coordination complexes. What are the different colors acquired by the different coordination complexes? Also go through the colors of lanthanide complexes. Next point which you need to cover is the magnetism. Metal complexes that have unpaired electrons are magnetic. So go through it, go through the various terms which are used to describe this. Now the next point is the reactivity of different complexes. Like they undergo electron transfer, ligand exchange, associative processes like complexes that have unfilled or half-filled orbitals often show the capability to react with substrates. Example, water, amines, ethers, etc. Then after this, you need to cover the classification. The areas of coordination chemistry can be classified according to the nature of the ligands. Go through them. For example, classical organometallic chemistry, bioinorganic chemistry, cluster chemistry, etc. Then how the nomenclature of these complexes are done. What is stability constant? The affinity of metal ions for ligands is described by stability constant. So what is the formula for that? Then after that, what are the various applications of coordination compounds? For example, some complex ions include in substances like vitamin B12, hemoglobin, chlorophyll, which have biological functions. Many enzymes are metal complexes like carboxypeptidase. So these are also used widely in industries. They are used as dyes for fabrics. Cyanide complexes are often used in electrophile plating. They are used in photography, gold plating, and EDTA is used for the estimation of calcium magnesium ion in hard water. So there are plenty of applications of coordination compounds, so go through them. They are very important for the exam purpose. So this was all about the S, P and D block elements. Questions that come from here are generally 1 to 2 marks. Time which you will need for its preparation is around 3 to 4 days. You should be thorough with the chemical and physical properties of the S, P and D block elements. Theories related to the coordination complexes, all the basics should be clear. And most importantly, go through the maximum number of examples of all of these topics. I wish you good luck and hope the information which I share is going to be helpful for you. Thank you.